Okay. Hello, lovely viewers. You saw nothing. Certainly not a copyrighted logo that I may or may not be using without permission. Anyways, we're... there's only one camera going. What is happening? What are you doing? We are gathered here today so that I can... Well, I'm already partway there, but so that I can be inebriated and go through the history of exalted Onyx Paths. Technically, they do belong to... It does belong to White Wolf Publishing Incorporated. Exalted setting. Copyright Paradox Interactive. I think. Someone get back to me in the comments of whether or not Paradox owns Exalted or Onyx Path owns Exalted. So I'm really confused about that one. Everything else makes perfect sense, but that one is really kind of up in the air. Also, this video features drinking. Probably a lot of swearing.
What the fuck?
There are other people obviously in the room to encourage me and remind me of where the fuck I am when I get, like, really drunk. I have no idea what I'm saying. But, yeah. Exalted is a wonderful setting with a very, 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 very rich history. There's a lot, and we're not gonna cover every... We're gonna cover everything. We're gonna cover everything that I know of and remember. So that excludes the Terrestrial and Celestial Direction books from 2nd edition, because I didn't read those. I was never a fan of setting books. I probably won't read under Different Skies, but I might, because it's supposed to be a new kind of approach to it, and I kind of want to see what the team is doing. I love 3rd edition. I love what the team has done. Love it. Love it. So, there's my biases. I did read the Abyssal's book, but not necessarily the Infernal's book. So, spoilers from 2nd edition. Just so you know. I don't know how many of them are actually going to be real, but we're starting at the very, very, very beginning with the canonical by the word of White Wolf. Ink Monkeys prehistory sort of thing. And since there's a new developer as well, I figured it was a good place to start. In the beginning of all everything, there was chaos. So in the beginning, there was endless, formless possibility. The Dreaming Sea, the Wild, it's known by many names, but chaos. Nothing had form. Everything was possibility. In that possibility, there did, however, exist, and I forget all of them, but there did exist stable concepts known as the Shinma. The Shinma are conceptions that expand beyond and exist beyond the scope of everything. They're things like identity. They're things... there's a Shinma for identity. There's a Shinma for a distance. Theoretically. I think there is. There's a Shinma for empathy, i.e. your relation to other things. Not so much your relationship to other humans, but the Shinma of empathy is your relationship to everyone else. Oh, there's a Shinma of purpose. So these... Yes, it was a formless sea, and yes, there was the Wild, but there are concepts that give meaning, if not structure. From the interaction of the Wild and these concepts, two things came to be. The Raksha, the Fair Folk, and the Primordials. And at first, the Raksha believed the Primordials to be just Raksha with slightly more coherent stories. Because the Raksha are stories. They are... Oh, the Shadow of Time eventually came to be during this point. The first... I forget who the first primordial was. But I know it was the Divine Ignition. I forget her name, but it was the Divine Ignition. She rose from the Sea of Chaos and said, I am, and then she was. Separated from the sea, she became an entity. She's Cybeline now. Or then. I don't remember. But the Divine Ignition was the first. And so, like many creation myths, in separating herself, she created the other. I don't exactly remember what the other was, but that's okay. This is all very vague, because it's been a really long time since I actually read the Ink Monkey's poem of creation. Whatever the fuck it was. Whatever it was called. But, great work, by the way, guys. So she was, and she went, and she traveled through the endless chaos, and travel being another Shinma distance. I said that. Then she traveled through the endless chaos, and she found Oramus, the dragon at the end of... The dragon beyond time. No, the dragon beyond the end of the world. And, you know, they had a conversation, something about, I've been waiting for you, and it's been forever, and come, we must go and find the others. And so, the primordials went around and gathered themselves together. And being together, they decided that we should create. We are creatures of the endless chaos. Why should we not? And they did. So Gaia and Atokthan and Cybeline and Marduk and all the other primordials, they got together and they made a world. And they called it Zedmu. There's some other shit that happens, but we're going to skip over that because it's not perfectly relevant to, and I don't remember it. More importantly, I don't remember it. They made a world and they called it Zedmu, and everything was hunky-dory, kinda, sorta. I don't remember what the impetus was, but eventually, Gaia decided that she did not want to continue. She decided that there were other vistas. She was tired of being stuck in one place. She had had her fun with Zenmu and was off in search of other things. And so she went off. And she tried again. Away from her primordial brethren, she created. And from the raw stuff of the wild, she pulled out form and she gave it structure. With her children, the elemental dragons, she gave it life. Eventually, her brothers and sisters came, because they could not not come. Something about being a primordial. And they discovered it, and they found creation. It doesn't have a fancy name, because it's the creation that the characters adventure in. This is the world. So eventually, primordials... It'd be really cool if that was edited out with, like, just the squeak. Like, so then the other were...
Fine, I'll do it.
I mean, like, it doesn't have to be. I'm just saying.
No, I'm gonna do it now. Fuck you. That's gonna be a hell of a wave manipulation, but who gives a fuck?
They came, and they saw what Gaia had wrought, and they thought, this is really amazing, and you're really cool, and can we get in on this? And Gaia was like, well... So they're like, alright, fine. We'll make heaven, where we can sit and we can play our games of divinities, and we'll make gods to manage creation for you. And God was like, oh, that actually sounds really cool. So the primordials created Yushan, heaven. And they created the Jade Pleasure Dome, and they sat at the games of divinity, and they made creation into what it is. They made gods, they gave it life, they did all sorts of things. Life needs light. This is a truth that Gaia had built into the world that was not escaping the other primordials. And so, Malpheus, the greatest of the primordials, there's something about Marduk gets killed in Zenmu? Or something to that effect. One of the primordials goes power mad inside Zenmu, and that's what originally prompts Gaia to leave, and then the rest of the primordials come to Gaia, and they've destroyed whoever went crazy, and... or they've banished him or whatever, and but Zenmu is a blasted wasteland, and so they need something more to entertain themselves, and Gaia says, well, fine, come with me. Or they just kind of intrude. I have the feeling that they just kind of intrude on what Gaia has created. It makes for a better story that way, in my humble opinion. So Malpheus gives of himself to Cybeline, the divine ignition, and they make a god to be the sun. But the original god, the sun that is in Zenmu, is green, because Malpheus is green fire, for some reason. And he says, and you know, he says to Cybeline, this will not do, it must be purified. And so the divine ignition goes to work on the Malphian soul. In the process of creating the sun, it becomes such that the god that represents the sun is no longer a part of any of the primordials. They've like three different primordials are involved in the creation of the unconquered sun, and I forget which three. I know Malpheus is the originator, and then I believe it's Cybeline purifies and someone else forges him into Sol Invictus. And in so doing, Sol Invictus is not a part of any of the primordials. All of the gods are bound by the primordial rules, which state that they cannot rise against their masters. It is built into their very nature. The hierarchy of heaven is absolute. None can counteract it. Not directly, anyways. But now they have a paradox. Now the primordials, through their combined might, have created this god that is a part of none of them, who is quite literally Sol Invictus. He is the unconquered sun. You can see why this might be a problem later on. They create Luna, the ever-changing moon, to battle the tides of the wild, and in so doing, create a being that is immune to the lures of chaos. Of which... bless you.
Trying so hard not to sneeze.
What
was
that?
It was a not sneeze. So they now have a being that is not part of any of them, and a being that is completely immune to the very stuff that they are made out of. This doesn't end well. In time... oh, Sharon's questions.
Trying so hard not to. It didn't work.
Well, it never works.
You can get me another beer then, please.
Okay. I think I'll drink one already.
This is the end of what you brought.
Is there still something in the fridge?
Oh my god, there's so much in the fridge.
So we didn't see enough of what we brought. He also was drinking them.
Yeah, he had like... wow.
Well, he needs to get drunk. That's how drunk history works.
Okay, well, that's fair. I'm glad I had some whiskey before I came, so...
do you want to grab... do you want to grab the case out of the fridge and just bring it over here?
Sure.
I think the half case will be fine for now, but...
you should just bring the full case.
How many have you had, Dennis?
This is my third one.
And he's a two-beer queer.
Yeah. Two-beer queer.
Okay.
I've got the gays.
This is an ace pack.
You're a pack.
She didn't listen.
Oh, snap.
Niecy said just bring a full one.
Oh, that's fine. We can use three more.
Yeah.
Huh?
It wasn't much.
That's fine.
So,
is there actually a case in there, or is it just another six?
Another
no,
pack.
It's another... that's why I was calling him a lying queer.
Yeah, he's a lying queer, motherfucker.
Okay, so give me a second,
queers,
I'm going to get my...
I mean, boy queers, by definition, are not motherfuckers.
Queer for the lying queer.
That is correct. Yeah. Yeah. That depends on the boy queer.
That's legit.
What kind of psychosis
and
the boy
what
queer
kind
may
of
have? What kind of mother?
That seems intelligent, Sharon.
What did she do?
I took a Zyrtec with a swig of beer.
That
it's what? Zyrtec.
It's Zyrtec.
That's fair.
Yeah, it's like that's
not what I thought.
That's
not
gonna do shit.
Oh no, it's not the other stuff. So
because yeah, I'm like, I said allergy med and she didn't respond. I'm like, oh, it might be the other stuff.
I said yes.
Oh, I totally didn't hear that.
The other stuff isn't gonna make me stop sneezing on camera.
Okay.
I had tested structural capacity.
Does it matter?
Yeah, no. Because I don't want to miss anything. Oh, all right. So they create these two babies.
No, I mean the label. Does it matter?
Oh no, I just saw you doing it, so I was doing it.
Okay. I'm just checking. I don't know what they're.
I don't fucking know either. I figured I'd rather be safe than sorry.
That's
but,
fair. All
right.
Well, that's fine. We just have all this other shit everywhere.
Right? I know.
Okay. Okay. So they created two beans.
That were problematic, and of course didn't see the problem in any of this. So the Unkirker son went forth in the Daystar, built for him by Autochthon, and shone light over the world, and during the night, Luna rose up, and she protected the world from the endless chaos at the edges of creation. And the primordials pushed back the tides of the wild, and everything was good for a time, and eventually, the Unconquered Son gets tired of this. He is the Unconquered Son. His very nature prohibits him from following orders. He is Sol Invictus. He is unbeaten. He literally, the fact that he has to sit here and listen to what the Primordials do or do not want and play as they wish according to the games of divinity bothers him. So Luna comes to him and she says, how fair is it that the Primordials are sitting in the Jade Pleasure Dome in Yushan while we here toil on the face of creation to make sure everything runs okay. It's not. I mean, maybe we should do something about this. And so the Unconquered Son wonders what she has in mind. Actually, the Unconquered Son doesn't wonder shit. The Unconquered Son says, you know what? That's a great idea. I'm glad I had it. And Luna smiles and says, of course, dear. And then he wanders off. And he spies mortals, these beings whom the Primordials have chosen to give free will because they are weak and insignificant. And what the fuck are they going to do? I mean, the Dragon Kings, who worship Sol Invictus, have more capability than fucking mortals. Really, what are these hairless apes going to do? There's so many bad decisions, like, in the entire history of Exalted that after a while, it just kind of hurts. But really, bad decisions are the core of good drama. So the Unconquered Son sees them, and he sees being a creation of unlimited virtue. He sees the potential of humanity. And he goes to Luna, and he says, what about these guys? And Luna says, no, it's actually not a bad idea. I mean, they're susceptible to the wild, and they're weak, and they could easily be squished, but no one expects them. I like this plan. What are you gonna do about it? And the Unconquered Son is not full of guile, but has noticed that, you know, Autochthon is kind of displeased with the Primordials. Being a creator god, the lack of creation bothers him. Gaia is kind of displeased with the Primordials. They kind of butted in on her shit. They're kind of running amok on her world. And so the Unconquered Son approaches these two Primordials, and presumably others, although he gets turned down at some point, but he approaches these two in particular. They're important for the rest of the story. And he says, I'm tired of this. I'm tired of working for the Primordials. I'm tired of doing their dirty work. I'm just tired of their hegemony. What do we do about it? And Gaia says, I don't know, but keep me posted. And Autochthon says, I have an idea. If you give me a portion of your power, and if any other gods wish to participate, they can also join. I can make something since you, of course, cannot betray the primordials, you know, you can't do anything. Let's see what we can make. And so the unconquered son says, great. And so he talks to Luna, and so, you know, he goes to Luna and he says, Octothon has a plan, but it requires some more of our plan. Our power. Luna signs up. And he goes to the Five Maidens of Destiny and he says, Octothon has a plan. And they say, say no more, we already know, because we're the Five Maidens of Destiny and we work the Loom of Fate that Octothon built. We're up. We're in. Also, you don't know where we came from because we just kind of showed up one day, and actually I don't think the Primordials know where we came from because we're fucking mysterious. And so the Five Maidens of Destiny are suddenly on board.
Wait, where did they come from?
No one knows. True fact. The Five Maidens of Destiny just showed up one day to work the Loom of Fate. Autothon didn't make them. None of the Primordials claim ownership of them. No one made the Maidens of Destiny. They just showed up. Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. Several people, scholars, suspect that they are beings out of time. That being Maidens of Destiny and coming from the Loom, that the Loom itself made them. We'll see how that holds out with the introduction of several new exalted types that challenge the established viewpoints. But they are not creations of primordials. Somehow still bound to their rules because they are gods. It's weird. It's weird. So, you know, oh, the elemental, no, the elemental dragons don't do shit. Gaia turns to them and elemental dragons and says, you will contribute, and the elemental dragons say, yes. And so the elemental dragons and the five maidens and the Sol Invictus and Luna all go to Autochthon, and Autochthon creates the Exalted. The exaltations of the Five Maidens and Sol Invictus and Luna are inherited by reincarnation. They are given to a given mortal, and then they are, when that mortal dies, they pass on to a new mortal. The 10,000 dragons, because originally there were 10,000 terrestrial exalted, 2,000 from each element, air, fire, water, earth, wood, spend the next, I think, like, 500 years? 250, 500 years in these ridiculous orgies. Because the power of the terrestrial exalted is passed by bloodline. So they have to now breed an army. So, and they have a lifespan of about 500 to 800 years. Well, it's actually like 500 years on the good side. These are the first generation, though, so they are purely imbued with the power of the elemental dragons. They get up to some shit. But it's like, you know, a generation, 2-3 generations of just orgies. Until they have the host. The terrestrial exalted host. These are the foot soldiers. And the solar exalted, and the lunar exalted, and the celestial exalted, the stereos, all have their roles. And so, in secret, this army of mortals, completely unbeknownst to the primordials, hidden presumably by Gaia and Autochthon, form an army. And they form a well-planned and strategic units, legions, army, capable of taking on the primordials. And then they go to war. The gods cannot help them. The very people who made them have their hands literally tied. The very nature of their essence prevents them from waging war on the primordials. So humans, people, average Joes, blessed by the excellence of the unconquered sun, the survival instincts of Luna, the foresight of the Sidereals, and the sheer raw elemental power of the terrestrial exalted, go to war against the very creators of the universe. The first beings of form that ever existed. And they're winning. The first primordial to fall literally sends shockwaves of fear throughout the rest of his brethren. No one knew that they could die. But the Solar Exalted are children of Sol Invictus. Their very essence states that they will do the impossible and make real that which is unreal. So they kill one primordial, and then two, and then three, and then seven. Or God knows, however many. Some flee into the wild. The rest of them eventually realize that the Exalted Host will be at their door, and they will kill them without a second thought. And so they deliver terms. The remaining primordials will live, separated from creation, in a realm created from the bodies of Malphius, the greatest among them. In exchange, the Exalted will gain creation, and the gods will gain heaven. Because creation cannot run without divine interference, shall we say. So the Solar Exalted, on behalf of their Exalted Master, the Exalted Host, on behalf of their Divine Masters, agrees. The body of Malphius, the body of one of the greatest of the Primordials, is turned into a prison. With very specific rules about how elements can enter and exit, Cybeline separates another one of the Primordials, the Divine Ignition, separates Malphius from the rest of creation. In a wasteland that kills most of the unprotected and is 5 days removed from the time stream. Fun fact, when you summon a demon, that demon is aware of that summoning 5 days before you actually perform the summoning, and then has to travel through the deserts to get to when you summon it. Cool little factoid.
Is that why they're so pissy now?
Yes! Yes, it is, because they just traveled 5 days through a deadly fucking wasteland. Because you got a wild hair up your ass that you needed a demon for some shit.
So that's why they're always pissed off when they get there.
Yeah, that's what Sharon said.
That's why I just...
Well, how about you're a woman? I wasn't listening.
I want to edit that.
No.
No, it's not. I'm leaving that in.
Mm-hmm.
I joke. I listen to Sharon a lot. I just missed her comment this time.
Well, you can cut that.
So the actual answer is Nock never actually listens to Sharon and pretends he listens to Sharon, and then when he realizes he actually didn't hear what he said, he pretends he thought of it first.
Yeah, you see, adorable. we can totally go do something this weekend, that's fine.
Yeah, see?
See what?
So exactly. Much fun. Like so the Exalted win! They defy the very creators of the universe, and they fucking win! And of course, everyone was shocked. So the gods retired, the Primordials leave, the remaining Primordials, who are still alive, end up in Malphius, inside the body of one of their comrades, basically to just fuck around and do as they wish, because they're fucking trapped there for all eternity. Yeah, that doesn't go very well, and that comes back later, but we'll get there. No one enjoys being entrapped for eternity. And the gods get heaven! And so they retire to heaven, and they give, you know, they who have run creation for so long, leave the basic processes in creation. And the Celestial Host then retires to heaven. And Sol Invictus turns to the Solar Exalted, and he says, you know, we're going to heaven, and unto you I bequeath the mandate that you shall rule creation. You will act with my word and in my stead on behalf of all of it. To you I give the creation ruling mandate. And since you act with my word, all the gods who are here to run creation physically must obey your words. Ta-da! He gives it under Queen Mira, I think, is the first leader of the Solar Deliberative. There is a second Solar Deliberative. Things don't go so great. And so Mira sets up government. She establishes the Solar Deliberative. She is the first and greatest queen of the Solar Exalted. They attribute everything to Queen Mira. The structure of the Deliberative, true or false. They attribute everything to Quaid Mera. The structure of the deliberative, the obtaining of the creation of one mandate. There's a story wherein apparently she goes to the Daystar and looks at Sol Invictus and demands the creation of the Willing Mandate. It's apocryphal in the First Age, but it's a story that exists. Who knows what the actual truth is? And, like, everything is attributed to Queen Mira. So she establishes the capital at Rathus, the former capital of the Dragon Kings, who are now greatly decimated by their war because they worship Sol Invictus, so they fought with the Solar Exalted. And she establishes the First Deliberative, and everything goes great for a time. Eventually, the whole of creation is too great to rule from Rathus. The areas that have been called... Gaia herself puts the elemental dragons to sleep, that the face of creation might be calm enough for humans to survive in. Because before, you know, the Dragon of Fire wiggles a little bit, and suddenly, like, an entire quarter of creation is on fire. It's the frozen north! Yeah, I don't care! Burning! You know, the Dragon of Earth and the Dragon of Fire decide to tussle around and get it going, and suddenly there's volcanoes everywhere, and who the fuck knows why? So, creation beforehand is a kind of a terrible place to live. Especially if you're a dude. What was that? The
squeak. Sorry. He's going to town with the chair.
No, yep.
Fuck yeah.
He does it often.
They said you pooped all of a sudden.
What? No. You know, and so Queen Mira creates and colonizes this newly quieted creation and realizes eventually that it's not big enough to rule from Rathus. Rathus, by the way, is in the east, southeast. The eastern southeast. So it's E-S-E. E-E-S-E, maybe. She dies. And the deliberative doesn't have rules for how to elect a new monarch. Because it's not an elective monarchy, and Mira didn't leave any children. So they're thinking, like, oh, we'll just let the next incarnation of Mira take over because it's going to be the same soul. Except the next incarnation of Mira never shows up again. So after about 50, 75 years, I don't know the exact time frame, but after a time, the deliberative realizes that they're not getting another monarch. Civil war! It's a short succession war. Succession war. But it is the first war amongst the Solar Exalted. And they start wrecking house. These are people who defeated the very creators of the universe. To say that they can unravel the fabric of creation is a given. And they do. And it doesn't end well. Eventually, the Lunars and the Sidereals and the other Exalted kind of corral them and make them realize what they're doing. So they get together, the Deliberative gets together and realizes that they can't have a queen, they can't have a monarch. They send the symbols of office back up to the Daystar. They move the capital to the Imperial Mountain, wherein they build a city called Meru, after Mira. Meru, M-E-R-U. They build a city at the top of the Imperial Mountain, the elemental pole of Earth, the very center of creation. And they refound the second Solar Deliberative, because most of the first Deliberative members are dead. Civil War does that to people. The period of the Second Solar Deliberative is the golden age of creation. At one point, there is a war, as one of the primordials who fled to the wild has come back as a being capable of destruction. Not capable of destruction, built for destruction. It has reorganized the entirety of its multiple-souled existence to be the destruction of the Solars. It's a war that very nearly wipes out the Exalted Host and the Deliberative, but eventually it is won. Which I think just contributes to the problems, especially since, you know, they just had a civil war, and they are not ready to repel an invasion from outside the boundaries of creation. That war leads to the founding of the Creation Defense Network, which comes into play later, as well as the Imperial Mance, outside of Miro in a small settlement on a river on the Blessed Isle. Totally not important. Doesn't become the center of the world later. I don't know what you're talking about. Time passes. Flashback to the Primordial War, when people, when the very creators of the universe basically died. Well, problem being, they're the founders of the universe. The form and structure are basically held up by them. Principles of existence that exist throughout everything are woven into their very being. Death is kind of not really a problem at that point. However, the very rules that they uphold by existing dictate that they have to die. Apparently Rigo's not fighting.
He doesn't get to play Minecraft tonight.
Nope.
The very rules of existence dictate that they have to die. But the very rules of existence can't let them die because it dies with them. So, Oblivion, the end of all things, is... Oblivion is apparently a concept at this point, because the Primordials who die are depicted as drifting ever closer, but very much like the event horizon of a black hole, never actually being able to fall in. So the Neverborn, and fully conscious! The Primordials who are dead are fully conscious of everything that's happened. They understand at a very intrinsic level that they cannot die. That they will never be small enough to fit in Oblivion. And so they sit at that edge for what seems like eternity, should be dead, but can't die. Needless to say, they go fucking nuts. The underworld is built, supposedly, on the bodies of these dead primordials, although no one knows that anymore. They create what is linguistically known as a repair strategy. Since these primordials should die but can't, they create a separate realm of existence. Or a separate realm of existence is birthed to accommodate this paradox. And that is the underworld. It is a place where souls go who are not ready to pass on to their next existence, or can't pass on to their next existence, but for whom their current existence in creation is ended. The Neverborn are nuts. They're complex souls are now agents of Oblivion. Eventually, the idea spreads amongst all of them that if they destroy everything, if they end creation, if they destroy form, they will be able to fade back into non-existence. And that is the solution. So, it's a bad idea. Obviously.
Like, the stupid heavyweight, too. Like the kind where, like, you expect someone to... Okay, hilarity story. Hilarious story. We were dating for a while. And so I took her out to get drunk. She was having kind of a bad day. So I took her to AFK. This is actually going to be in the video.
Awesome.
I took her to AFK Tavern up in Everett. Because they have a whole bunch of really cool frou-frou drinks, and, I mean, just fucking, it's awesome.
I've heard about it.
Yeah, and so, when I took her, she's
in nothing.
Okay. So, I took her up there, and, like, we started drinking, and I was like, alright, cool, we'll have a few drinks, and she didn't stop.
Oh.
So, like,
oh,
we got our bill, and it was, like, $160?
What?
Just for her? That wasn't any of my drinks.
Damn.
Jesus.
And, I mean, their drinks are expensive, but they're like $5-6 a drink. They're not $10 a drink.
That's not really expensive.
I'm from South Dakota, so if you pay it over $3, it's a little expensive on my side. But
I'm used to 14, so I'm just like, well,
that's fair.
It's not bad.
New York?
Boston.
Oh, yeah. My friend Mara is like, anytime she's paying less than $10 a drink, she's super excited.
I know, that's
right.
Why I'm like,
oh my god, yay!
So first started drinking in Boston, all I saw were like $12, $14 drinks. Like,
yeah.
Just seems...
You know, on my side, I'm just like...
I'll take one.
So, I hope you told the story.
Okay, so I didn't finish the story. So I got her, like, stupid drunk. Like, beyond stupid drunk. So I tried to get her to come home with me so we could sleep together. Well, that didn't work. So then, I took her home, and when I took her home, she was talking to me in the car about some anime shit or something. I was quite drunk myself, so to be fair, I don't remember the exact conversation. However, the best part is she said she was going to say goodnight, but she wanted to tell me one final thing. So she opens the door on my car, and this is in fucking...
middle of winter.
Nearly the middle of winter.
Yeah.
It's late fall. She opens the car door, and she turns around and looks at me and stares at me for 15 minutes. Thinking she's talking to me, all she did was look at me for 15 minutes.
See, I think the story is better told if you just tell it from my perspective, in which I'm talking at her, and then as I'm talking, I see her expression go from, like, politely interested to confused to annoyed. And I finally just say bye, shut the fuck up and say bye, and then I go inside, and I think, I annoyed Nisi because I wouldn't shut up.
And yeah, Nock and I are still, we're all, the three of us are living together at this point, and Nock and I are still up for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are.
Yeah, I think I had the next day off from both of my jobs at the time, so I was like, oh my god, I'm just able to do all the things! Which was, for the record, if you're ever working two jobs, that's never the right answer. I know it sounds like a really good idea, but don't do it.
Don't do it.
Go to fucking sleep, and then do everything the next day.
Yeah.
But, like, she comes in, she's like, oh my god, I think I totally... And, like, I look up from whatever I'm doing... I was playing a game. I look up from whatever I'm doing, and I'm like, you're home. What time is it? Good God!
Yeah. So I thought I had just talked her ear off and annoyed the hell out of her.
Like, oh my god, I think I ignored her. I think I ruined it. I'm like, well, you know what? Whatever. If it's ruined, it's ruined. And I mean, like, who the fuck cares?
Like,
my general philosophy of everything.
So the next day I apologize for talking your ear off, and she's like, you didn't say anything. And I'm like, oh. I think the story is funnier if you didn't know that until I say that sentence. I apologize.
I'm really sorry I talked to you wrong last night. You weren't actually talking.
Which explains the expression progression a lot better.
Yeah, because if she's talking, I wouldn't care, because I was trying to sleep with her. So, you know, I'll listen to whatever I need to sleep with someone.
You're still talking with me, so that means I still have a chance to
Right?
Get
exactly.
In there.
You're still talking. You haven't left yet. As long as you haven't left yet, I'm still good. I still got you. I'm so drunk at this point. Yes, that's my thought process.
We're going to politely ignore the fact that Nisi is driving drunk at this point.
No, I'm not. She's driving.
What?
That's not...
Dick.
No, he meant the story, sweetheart.
Oh, no, I wasn't drunk during the drive. I was completely sober during the drive.
Yeah. Don't drink and drive.
Don't drink and drive. That's terrible.
See what
I
mean?
I will be driving the bus.
Clearly a point that I should not be driving.
Clearly. Take the bus. Make sure you take the bus.
That seems to be the officer problem.
Yes. Anyways, where the fuck was I? Oh, so I was explaining the Neverborn.
Yeah.
Neverborn are crazy.
The Neverborn are fucking crazy. A.K.A. the Primordial, who have now died because of the Primordial World, are known as Primordial War, are known as the Neverborn because they were never born. They're Primordials. No one knows that, FYI. This is kind of, like, out-of-character meta-knowledge. A lot of this is out-of-character meta-knowledge. So if you play that character concept that knows everything the fuck that I'm spouting out, you're a terrible player and should be fired! Moving on. The whole point of that was, when the Primordial were first killed, they laid a curse upon the Exalted. That they should know their pain and suffering, and that always be hounded by the very betrayal that the Exalted perpetrated on them. That was the curse. It's known as the Great Curse. But no one really paid it any mind, because who pays attention to the words of people who are dying? The moral of the story is fucking everyone should, because it's generally an important event. So, the second deliverative happens. Forces from beyond... A couple of the few primordials who had fled during the war come back, ready to kill the Solar Host. Fail, thankfully, but not without significant losses. The Solar Deliberative rebuilds itself and rebuilds creation. Enter a long reign of peace that is colloquially referred to as the First Age. Now, technically speaking, the First Age covers everything from the beginning of creation until the usurpation. However, generally, when in character or when in character texts refer to the First Age, they are specifically referring to the solar peace that happens after all of this turbulence in the Second Deliberative, which most people don't know is the Second Deliberative. This is the time period that takes place in. So the Solars rule for untold millennium. Centuries. Untold centuries. And then finally, you know, as time passes, as these Solars who are now living, who have never known conflict, who have never had to reincarnate, grow older and older and older, and as the Great Curse just kind of accumulates in the hosts of the Exalted, things get bad. Being the rulers of creation for so long, the Solar Exalted become hubristic. They become prideful, and they start not necessarily caring about their charges. As the ruling class, you know, to them, the lessers have running water, they have amenities, they have power, they have everything that they could hope for. Why should I care about them? And they start demeaning the value of singular human lives, which is a problem, because the Solars are fundamentally human. They are people, which is one of the, I think, the miracles of third edition, is that it kind of highlights the fact that Solar Exalted come from people, that you are still a person, first and foremost, just a person with unimaginable power. It gets bad. It gets really, really bad. Really, 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 really bad. The Sidereals, during a calibration, cast fortunes, and they see for creation three possible fates. In the first, they do nothing. They let the Solars go fucking nuts, and the Solars annihilate creation. In the second, they annihilate the Solars. They rise up, find a way to kill and imprison them and remove the Solar presence from creation, and creation limps onward. In the third, they succumb to the void. The Solars are corrupted from within, and they plunge everything into the end of time. They effectively, really the third is they do nothing, and the creation is plunged into oblivion and remade as something else from the endless fountains of the wild. Regular world of darkness. It's been hinted by the developers to move up a level. It's been hinted by the developers that the third vision, the vision of oblivion that the Sidereals had, is the way that you get to the Age of Sorrows becoming the sixth age of the classic World of Darkness. Just saying. It was in interviews. I've seen it. You can look up the original sources online. But the current Age of Sorrows from Exalted is not what they did. The three visions are collectively known as the Gold Vision, the Bronze Vision, and the Vision of Oblivion. The Sidereals are fairly divided as to what they want to do, but eventually the majority falls for the Bronze Vision, the Usurpation. Over the years, they collect support amongst the Dragon-Blooded, who have been horribly abused at the hands of the Solars, because the Solars are going crazy. Not the Lunars. Not that the Lunars aren't going crazy, but When the Lunar Exalted were made, Sol Invictus insisted that the Lunar Exalted be bound to the Solars, because he was the greatest among gods, and so his children should be the greatest. And Luna, ever the crafty bitch, looked at him and said, "Okay. For every Solar, there will be one Lunar Exaltation made to be their mate, to be subservient, and to help them." And Sol Invictus said yes. But that means that only one Lunar ever only has to listen to one Solar. Luna is a crafty bitch.
Loopholes!
Crafty bitch. Lunars are awesome, actually. Like, I love Lunars. I love that in 2nd edition, and I really hope that in 3rd edition they continue this trend of diversification. Playing a Solar is a distinctly different experience from playing a Lunar, from playing a Stair, from playing a Dragon-Blooded, and I love all of that. Anyway. So the Sidereals gain support from the Dragon-Blooded, and they decide that calibration... The Solar Exalted Year features 5 days when in everyone takes a vacation. All the gods of the terrestrial bureaucracy and the celestial bureaucracy are literally get 5 days of vacation at the end of the year, wherein they're not doing shit. So creation kind of tends to go crazy. And if you're average Joe Smo, it's definitely an unlucky time of the year. You do not initiate new projects. You do not undertake vast journeys. You don't do shit if you can help it. Because it's 5 days of the years when the people who generally organize on a spiritual level, everything you're doing ain't doing anything. It's like, I'm gonna come into work where I'm the highest paid employee and everyone else is on an equal salary base to me. All our bosses, they fucked off.
So
no supervisors, no managers, it's just all low-level employees running a business.
That sounds like fun. Let's do it.
Now it's 5 days, so people generally are able to get by. But you don't start brand new projects, and you don't initiate vast, sweeping changes to structure. Not during calibration. And part of that comes from the story of the usurpation. As far as, like, cultural identity and, like, hero folk tales, part of that definitely comes from the stories of the usurpation. The Deliberative had rules, obviously. It gave laws to the entirety of the Solar Exalted. Of them, one of the rules was that unless you had an undeniably damn good reason for not being at the calibration feast, the entirety of the Solar host was gathered together at the Solar feast of calibration. Solars are the masters, the undisputed masters of sorcery, and one of the higher level spells, sorcerer's spells, allows you to summon a third circle demon into the world, but it only works during calibration. It's one of the rules of the treaty that they formed with with Malphius and the Yozi kings. Third circle demons are the greater souls. They are the green sun liger. They are the very beings that can effectively accomplish the destruction of a vast swath of creation in a single thought. Generally speaking, the Solars wanted to keep an eye on one another, and so they made up the Solar Feast as a reason to get anyone who knew the spell in the same room so that everyone could be assured that that person wasn't summoning a third circle demon. All in all, a good reason, bad political move. 1 year during calibration, the Dragon-Blooded host rose up in full, and assaulted the feast. most of the Solar Host was killed. More importantly, the Solar Host that were killed did not reincarnate. Reason being, the Sidereals had set up what is known as the Jade Prison, construct from God knows where, supposedly delivered to them unto the Maidens. Delivered to unto them by the Maidens, although no one will verify that, that could trap the Solar Exaltations from returning to Lytec, the Daimyo of Exaltation, keeping them from the ability of being reincarnated. Lytec's job is to... Lytec has a cabinet where all Exaltations return to. His job is to approve individuals for Exaltation and appropriate unto them the proper Exaltation according to what they do. So, Stereos had built the Great Prison. Any Exalted killed during calibration would funnel into the Great Prison. They also assaulted Lytec's office and kind of knocked the god out so that he didn't know what the fuck was going on. And hooked up the Jade Prison into his cabinet, which is how they got most of the souls. The souls that died during the Exaltation, or during calibration, were not able to be reincarnated. They were trapped in the Jade Prison. During all of this, the Sidereals as well, in an effort to conceal themselves, broke a constellation and its associated destinies within Loom of Fate. The mask, associated with stealth and being hidden, so that there is never, will never, and has never been any evidence that the Sidereals were at all a part of the usurpation. You gotta cover your tracks. And if the price is the destinies of 50 million mortals, who the fuck cares? It's for a good cause, right? Rest of creation, right? The Dragonblood had slaughtered the Solar Exalted. The Lunars fucking vanish. Their first and primary mission is to survive. That is the rule. You can tell I'm getting drunk. Those are the rules that Luna gave to them. First and foremost, above all, survive. Secondly, serve your Solar. Thirdly, serve your pack. Actually, secondly, serve your pack. Thirdly, serve your Solar. So the Lunars disappeared into the edges of creation. And the Solars were gone. That calibration was... That 5-day interval was the end of the first age. After the Solars were gone, the dragon-blooded shogunate existed, wherein they retained the divisions and the associations that had served them as the dragon-blooded host underneath the Exalted, and continued governing creation as best as they were able to. Unfortunately, as best as they were able to isn't good enough. The Dragonblooded didn't have the creation ruling mandate. Spirits were not ordered by the greatest among them to listen to them in any way, shape, or form. They were the terrestrial Exalted. They were the least of the host, while they did the most work. Who gives a fuck? So, the Shogunate is not a blissful period in history. It's kind of fucked up. But they made do. And the Sidereals, seeing that the Dragonblooded needed something to validate their claims, created the Immaculate Faith. The Immaculate Faith basically states that spiritual perfection, the movement towards exaltation, subliminally towards Solar exaltation, lies in the cultivation of the soul and progresses through the different layers of exaltation. Now, the Immaculate Philosophy states that the pinnacle of achievement is terrestrial exaltation, is the belief in the Dragon-Blooded. But since a lot of the spirits know that the Immaculate Philosophers who are dealing with them are, in fact, sidereal exalted, the subtext to everything is that you progress through exaltation. So, from a human to a terrestrial to a celestial to a solar. And that the Solar had died, and no one was worthy of a Solar exaltation. They had to rebuild. thus the spirits of the terrestrial bureaucracy, the bureaucracy that handles, you know, weather phenomenon and just crops and farmlands and disease and all that other shit, were appeased by the dragon-blooded and the immaculate philosophy into thinking, well, eventually the soldiers will come back, but for now we're going to deal with these people because they're the next in line for the creation of the Holy Mandate. And it kind of worked. It was spotty. The Immaculate Philosophy wasn't any sort of regional faith. It was kind of a worldwide phenomenon, but it was cells and pockets throughout the world. During the shogunate, several different... Here's the treasure hunt of the week, viewers. Go to the fake game, figure out what Nisi put over Nock's head at one point, and then mention it in the comments.
And you will get...
Nothing. We have nothing to give you.
Yeah. You'll get a thumbs up.
Link the video of your choice, and we will actually go and like that video.
Yes, we will. Like whatever video of your choice if you get it right, and I will check. Probably.
Maybe. If we're feeling particularly feisty. Or if you post something that... Or if you link something that's particularly bad, then we'll just be like...
Yeah, if...
Did they get it right?
Sure!
Might have to check and see if we're thumbs up being like a Donald Trump thing. We might have to.
Okay, so full disclosure, and this may or may not make it to the final cut. I had a customer come in that night and be like, so did you hear? I just heard Judge Scalia died. I was like, oh my god, that. No idea. Like, just. Did not ring any bells, and so
he's
like,
the hateful asshole one.
No, I know.
Oh, okay.
And so I was like, oh my god, that's so terrible. I think. And he's like, he's like, yeah, I mean, like, he didn't really engage me, but I was just like, yeah, I mean, like, oh wow, I mean, like, you just heard about this? And he's like, yeah, like, I just heard. It's apparently gonna be, it's apparently, like, all over the news, and, like, Judge Scalia died. And, like, at the time, it seemed like he was really vested in this person having died. And so I was like, oh, I'm, wow, that sucks. I'm, you know, I'm really sorry. I'm like, I go home that night, and I'm like, oh, this dude. I think I gave that customer the wrong impression. Because he looked confused at certain points, like... Why are you sad about this?
Why are you sad?
And I'm like...
I have no idea who you're talking about.
It's like, very clearly, I don't know who you're talking about.
Okay, so since we're taking a slight break at the moment, so hilarity.
That's for the extra $5.
So someone posted, how does someone who believes that literal demons actually exist get appointed to the Supreme Court? And then he posts an excerpt from a court case where he actually says that he believes that demons are currently walking the earth. It's in a court opinion that he believes demons are actually walking the earth. Just mull on that for a little bit, Internet. Just mull on that. For just a minute.
Now we're on 5 different watch lists.
Not yet. It hasn't been uploaded yet.
Oh my
yet.
God. There's this fantastic...
Please take that out, Nisi.
There's a fantastic...
That's how drunk I am.
Please.
There's a fantastic crack
video. Future Nisi, please take that out.
I'm trying to tell a joke. Sorry. Fantastic crack video in which... it's a follow-up to a previous video talking about things that are difficult in movies that are easy in real life. One of them was changing babies. And they're talking about how if it's a boy baby, it'll end up peeing on you. But if you're a guy, it'll pee on your shirt. If you're a girl, it'll pee in your face. And he shows a whole bunch of clips from movies. And at the end of that segment, he's like, and if the search terms I use to find those clips haven't put me on a watch list, then I am really disappointed in our government.
I accept the fact that I am on at least 2 or 3 different watch lists. A, I write. The shit you look up for in that case is just kind of going to get you on a watch list. B, my now husband was part of military intelligence, so I fully accept that the government is watching everything I fucking do. It just comes with the territory. See, I accept that everyone is on a watch list at this point. I mean, like, really.
So I have a coworker who is shockingly ignorant of a bunch of things, but...
Oh, God. No good story ever starts that way.
She's not dumb, but she clearly did not get the education she needed.
That's unfortunate.
So she has questionable beliefs as a consequence. One of them is she believes in the Illuminati as a actual literal thing. And she... her husband once Googled the Illuminati, and her computer started fucking up as a consequence, and she thinks that those two things were related to each other. And I'm just wondering if the Illuminati watch list is at all impressed with my secret world build for the number of times I have Googled Illuminati.
I hope so.
Yeah, I put a lot of work into that.
It's really important.
You really did. Where did they go?
He took them home. No? Oh, do you go get food or something? Okay.
Casa, which I think is a Mexican place, but I just texted him, and I'm like, if that's the pho place, will you bring me pho? Pho. Sorry, pho.
It's pho.
If it's...
It can be pho, it's...
No,
all
it's
Casa?
Pho.
Fuck you, it's pho now.
We're by it. I can pick you up, son. Fucking sweet.
What about poo?
No.
Is it poo?
It's P-H-O.
Poo.
Poo.
Anyway, so I'm just saying, the guy deserved to die. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
You deserve to die a fuck of a lot sooner, but...
There's a couple other people that deserve to die at the same time, but, you know what?
And I fully agree that we should maybe deliberate as a country as to what we do with his remains. Because clearly, he doesn't get to decide. And if his family doesn't like it, maybe you should have raised him better.
That shit's funny as fuck.
Sorry to get political on all up on our viewers. I'm making my pho order, and hopefully you will pick up the video from this point. And
well,
then
maybe we'll just pick it up from whatever point we feel like picking it up.
Or whatever point Misi feels like picking it up from.
Whatever point I feel like leaving in, and whatever point I don't feel like leaving in.
Whoever gets to be on whatever watch list, I guess.
Yeah.
I will be on all the watches that volunteer as tribute.
You volunteer.
I'm sorry.
I am so wasted right now.
You are adorable.
It feels good, man.
Yeah.
What was it? I was talking
because
to someone.
Because she's wasted. I'm the one who's supposed to be delivering the drunk history. Although, like, I can feel myself having trouble enunciating some of these phonemes, so I'm just like, maybe I'm more drunk than I thought I was.
Listening to The Wheel of Time,
yeah.
Like, every third word is a word like, that's an imaginary word I'm not going to remember.
So, in The Art of Language Invention, he actually talks about that and how you want to have a language that still sounds... And looks feasible, because otherwise people aren't going to fucking remember a goddamn shit about it.
And the thing is he actually does do that. However, there's a slight problem because... Shut up. There's a slight problem because they are Romanized characters, so they are pronounceable. There's a specific pronunciation guide. But the thing is the first book doesn't follow any of the rules.
Oh, God.
Because the first book wasn't sure if it was going to be published or not because Tor was, like, fucking being retarded.
Tor is retarded.
Well, they are. But they were being exceptionally retarded in the early 90s. Because Terry Goodkind...
Late 80s.
Okay, fair, late 80s. Because...
Pillow.
Oh, yeah. Because Terry Goodkind was competing for a book to be published.
He cannot have been competing for the first book. He's
still
too much.
One of my instructors at UCSD actually used to work for Tor as an editor, so... stories I've heard!
So that's a good question. Is that actually... Because that's what I heard from Harriet from RJ's wife.
Okay, so let me put it into perspective.
Wife.
I decided not to be a teacher because what I wanted to do was the same as being an editor. Come to find out from this instructor, teacher was the better option in terms of salary and benefits.
That's terrible.
Did he ever tell you about the issues between RJ between RJ and Goodkind?
She was working at the best early 90s. I'm sorry, at the best late 90s, early aughts.
Oh, okay. Well, never mind then.
Yeah, she would not have been there for that, but it was one of
those.
Yes, like,
of course.
Like, I remember having this conversation with her about, like, you know, like, oh, I totally was thinking about becoming an editor, and her being like,
yes,
instead of a teacher.
That's...
And her being like...
No, you don't know what I'm saying.
You want to probably rethink that teacher career path, because it's probably going to be better for you.
Yeah.
Like, in what terms? Just like, oh, you know, everything that matters. I'm like, so, like, pay grade and benefits and shit? And she's like, yeah, that. I'm like, ooh.
Wow.
Yeah. That's dumb.
So, yeah, the first Wheel of Time book was published in 1990. So it was not in conflict with the first Sword of Truth book because that was published 4 years later.
It was, and that's why it was published 4 years later.
It's hard for me to wrap my mind around that since, like, Terry Goodkind stole half of his ideas.
Yes.
And it's hard to do that
so
after or before publishing.
Here's the thing. So, they both know... This is what Harriet told me, specifically. This is from the late 1990s, roughly. 99-ish, 2000-ish. Because I went to a book signing. Obviously, because I was... Which, by the way, I'm still pissed at that motherfucker who had my books burned up that were first edition that were signed by Robert Jordan, because they can't be re-signed now. So you're a fucking whore, and you never replaced them, and I want you to die in a fire that you should have died in when you let my books burn. Because, really, that's what should have happened. You should have gone back into that fucking house, you should have grabbed those fucking books. You motherfucker.
No residual bitterness rage in this woman.
No, of course not. Never.
So
not for anything.
He needs to die. I forget his fucking name at this point.
Because I'm too drunk.
All I remember is my hatred.
I only...
This is the joy of Drunk and Exalted, is that like, midway through the story, we get into all of the tangents.
No, so like the motherfucker... So, dude, so I worked with this motherfucker for like 6 months at fucking...
I think Knock is bringing me pho, too, or something.
What fuck was it? I don't remember what company it was. It doesn't matter what company it was. It was a piece of shit company, because I don't work there anymore.
POS South Dakota.
Yes, piece of shit South Dakota. And so this motherfucker's like, oh, hey, because I was rereading The Wheel of Time, because they were going to release the 9th book, so I was rereading it.
Oh, my God.
Dude, I've read the first 10 books at least.
I need to reread, like, the Infernal Devices series and book 6 of The Mortal Instruments so I can be ready for the release on March 8 for Lady Midnight. Like, that's 4 books. I can't imagine rereading, like, 8 books just for the 9th book to come out. Like, fuck that noise.
Well, I did that for every book. And that doesn't count the rereads while I was waiting for the other books to be released.
Making sad.
So I literally reread the first 10 books, no joke, at least 20 times. At least 20. There's probably more than that. And that's okay. But I've wasted away my book knowledge. Keep your foot down. I've wasted away my alcohol knowledge and with the weed and shit I've been having since I moved here. So it's okay. So, and there's other reasons too.
Legalized recreational use.
Yeah. So, no, this motherfucker. So this motherfucker sees me reading fucking Wheel of Time. He's like, hey, what are you reading? I was like, oh, I'm on book 6 right now. I was rereading book 6. So book 9 was coming out in like January and this was like October. So I was like, alright, I'm rereading book 6 right now, and this is while I'm at work. And he's like, oh, cool, what is this? Like, that's the Wheel of Time. I explained, you know, high fantasy, whatever. I was like, I personally really like it, because it's the first fantasy series I really got into. But people like to compare it to, like, Tolkien and fucking, at the time, Sword of Truth and Shannara, or whatever it is.
As a brief aside, I had a customer come in who was like, Yeah, I tried to read through, like, Lord of the Rings, but it all seemed like a giant exercise for Tolkien to express all of these languages he'd created. My words, not his. So I kind of, like, just couldn't get into it. I'm like, that's kind of exactly why he wrote that.
Yeah, it is. Right?
But okay! Anyways, moving on.
So he asked if he could borrow the books. At the time, all I had was my signed first editions.
That was a lie. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know what?
Live and learn.
Live and learn.
And then get loves.
And then I was young. I was young at the time. I was like, sure, you can, no big deal. So I loaned him the first two. I got those back. No big deal. 3 through 7, however, were consumed in a fire.
Because his house burned down?
Because his house burned down.
Sweetheart, one book at a time would have saved you this issue.
You're right. It would have. However, I still would have lost that book.
Well, it would have been one.
We would have lost one book
five,
instead of nine.
Or however many numbers.
Yeah.
Five.
So I lost 5 books because this stupid cunt, who was a man, but apparently had a cunt because he was a pussy, decided he couldn't go into his fucking house and save the books that were loaned to him
that were burning.
First edition signed fucking copies from a dead goddamn author.
Was he dead at the time?
He was really close. He was really sick. We weren't sure if he was going to live to write the 10th book, so it was really close.
I got better.
He did. He got better for about 6 months, and then he died, and it was, like, really awkward. So, yeah. So that motherfucker needs to just go back into that fire, back in time, and just die.
Which is, it's not like his life was destroyed or anything.
Of course
no,
not.
No particular family heirlooms to save
no,
him from some stranger's books.
Like, no.
I wasn't a stranger. I was a motherfucking co-worker. His first edition signed copies. I was pissed.
I can't
for the
even
record,
tell.
No, honestly, internet, for the record, I know what books out of that collection I would save. Just so we're clear.
Okay, so I got 2 jokes, or 2 antidotes. First one is with her D&D game.
Anecdotes. Continues.
Yes.
Wait, what are we talking about now?
No idea, but I want to see where this goes.
So her D&D game, she has portals to fictional verses because it's fun. So we're bopping in and out. And we're...
Oh, I got it. Sorry.
Okay. So
it's Planescape.
Yeah, I know. It took me a second to work.
Yeah, Planescape with fictional verses, and we are currently in... Yes.
Numenara is making a game.
You are not following along.
No, I'm sorry. Tides of Torment has a lot of the same development crew as the original Planescape game.
Okay, I don't care.
Just so you know.
That's cool.
So, we'll pop it over into Wheel of Time. I am a paladin, and I'm talking to a character, and I'm saying, so I'm a traveler, and I just, you know, want to make sure I don't have any social faux pas. I legitimately don't know anything about this culture. Is there anything that you think you could just tell me, general stuff? And so he mentions, you know, of course, everybody here follows the Creator, and no one talks about the Dark One, and I'm like, the who and the what now? And he's really confused. And we talk back and forth for a little bit, and I'm super confused. I'm like, until I get to the point where I'm like, oh my god, you're a monotheist! I read a book about that once! And he has no idea, probably, what that word even means. Just great.
It was a pretty good
that
moment.
Sounds amazing.
It was a pretty good moment. Okay, no, so what I was talking about...
I'm not done yet.
Shut up. You're done. So...
I had another one.
No, you don't.
2.
No, you
I
don't.
I said 2.
You don't.
You just said 2.
It doesn't matter. So, I'm overwriting
the joys
her.
Of marriage.
Her. I'm overwriting her.
You bitch.
You should be happy they're not smelly this
time. The internet should be aware she just farted on me.
Just like I do in bed. I haven't done during sex yet, which is good. So we're okay. So,
divorce.
That gets awkward at that point. When you're eating pussy and then there's a fart that goes into your mouth. Kind of rolls into your mouth. Cause
yeah, no.
Yeah, no, that's kind of awkward. Ah, it's not fun.
Divorce you.
You can't divorce me for that.
Yes.
It's in our marriage vows. So.
I promise to stay with you even if you fart to my mouth while I'm going down on you.
We need to get back to the actual story at hand, which is
no, we don't.
Sad.
I thought
we were waiting for Nock to get back.
We are.
No.
No, okay.
Alright, so...
I was like, no.
Then shut up and let
me. No, I'm doing my. I still have my.
What the fuck do I need my husband to do anything? Like, fucking really?
So, no, my Harriet story, motherfuckers. We were talking about that. Mm-hmm. So, Harriet said that good kind knows people at the fucking office.
That is actually the original reason why we tangented.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, good kind knows people at the office. So, he got an advanced copy of Wheel of Time. And that's when he fucking read his book. Before the Wheel of Time got published. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's, like, lifted word for word in, like, nearly every aspect.
Because he got an advanced read copy?
Yes.
Mm. Well, it makes sense.
And that's the issue that they had, because he wrote his book. He was trying to publish it in, like, 91, right after Wheel of Time was going to come out, and Tor's like, guys, this is, like, identical. Like, you
this
can't.
Is, like, plagiarism? We can't do that.
Yeah, and that was the big fight, and that's why it was 94.
Okay.
Cool. Well, so they waited
that's...
4 years to publish it in the hopes that people would forget.
No, they made him edit it.
That's
the edited one.
Oh, that's fair.
That's the one that they were willing to publish. Harriet said the original was significantly worse.
I mean, props on the Tor editor. You guys do a lot of hard work. I'm just saying.
It sucks to be you in every single conceivable aspect.
That. Fight for better wages. Make a union.
Okay, so what was your second anecdotal evidence?
Anecdotal.
There's
a K sound in there.
Well, I was listening to...
There was a no.
I was listening to the audio book version. And
yeah, I just checked off in her face. Suck it, internet.
So, okay, everybody's making jerk-off motions. I forget the Aes Sedai's name, which is, by the way, never, ever in a million years how I would have thought that word is supposed to be pronounced.
Was it the color Moraine?
I keep forgetting her name.
Oh.
Okay,
because
so,
it's not, it doesn't go up.
It's mixed in with a lot of other imaginary words, and it sort of gets lost in the mix.
That's because you're bad at words.
You know, Matt is a name that I remember. Rand is even a name I remember. I don't remember the third fucker's name.
Perrin.
Sure. Why didn't they just name him Aaron or Pete?
Because Perrin is follows a...
And
okay,
no,
so,
shit,
no,
no, I'm still telling...
Fuck you, woman.
So,
no, you're done. No. So now you're done. So Perrin is actually following the name of one of... Ow! Of one of the ancient lines of fucking humans, and that's an actual name that was used a long time ago. Africa.
Okay.
Stop covering my mouth.
It's not my fault you don't understand the African language, so fuck you.
It is a... European fantasy novel.
It is not. It is actually an entire world fantasy novel. If you would actually read it and actually follow along, you would understand the Sea-chan are actually Asian.
So, anyway, she was talking and I realized, oh, she's the, mentor. That's why she dies. And that was just a little epiphany that I had. Such a simple thing that I could have done, like, nearly an hour ago if you would let me talk.
In, like, 20 minutes.
Spoilers.
It's not a spoiler, I mean...
Yes, I know, that's the joke. The book is over 10 years old.
It's 25 years old.
Okay.
The book's 25 years old.
Oh, God, it is. Anyways.
Yes.
The first three books are legally allowed to drink.
Yeah.
So Tor would just let their fucking copyright lapse. It'd be public domain.
Yeah, so I was just like, oh, she's the mentor. Oh, that's why she died. Just
well,
just I'm sitting at work, typing away, and...
It's not Tor's copyright. It actually is still his, and it's actually good for another... Theoretically, it'll lapse in the year 2119.
Well, that was 7 years at a time.
99 years after the lifetime of the person who wrote it. Unless it's repurchased.
So 7 years. Is it 7 years after repurchase date, then?
No. Copyrights last for 99 years after your death.
Right, and you just said unless it's repurchased.
Unless it's repurchased after that expiration date.
Yeah, and he wants to know if the expiration date is done in increments of 7 years.
No, expiration date is done at 99 years.
Maybe it's just the copyright.
Never mind.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. I know what I'm saying. I know what I'm saying.
Yes, you do know what you're saying, but you don't know what we're saying, which is why we can't ask you a question.
That's because what you're
saying is wrong. It's a question, and thus not wrong.
What's your question?
After the copyright expires...
No,
after
it's repurchased.
After it expires the first time, after the 99-year mark is done.
Oh, okay.
And someone purchases it, is it then good for 7 years?
My understanding is actually the opposite, is that after it's repurchased...
Mm-hmm.
So it's officially 99 years from until 99 years after the date of expiry of the original author, unless it is repurchased.
Mm-hmm.
So my understanding is that if it is repurchased within that time frame, your purchase of that copyright only lasts for 7 years.
Well, yeah, the purchase is what we're talking about.
Okay,
so
let me see. 28 years.
It's also been
So it's 28 years. So basically, as far as my understanding goes, it's 28 years when you first copyright an item. However, if it gets purchased, your expiration date is on 7 years from date of purchase. Meaning, if someone buys you out for your intellectual property before you die, they only have 7 years. And every 7 years, they have to renegotiate that purchase agreement for as long as you're alive.
Maybe.
If they buy you out, yes. In the case of Robert Jordan, it's going to be 99 years after he died, plus I'm assuming Harriet still probably retains the copyright?
Yeah, because... Because
she's an editor?
If she's smart, she's had up an estate, just like the Asimov estate.
Yeah.
And it's his copyrights, even though he's already dead.
Right.
They own the copyrights by right of he bequeathed them in his will.
Yes.
To that estate, ergo the estate manages the copyrights as though it was a living entity, despite the fact that he is deceased.
Right.
So they have the standard 28 years, I think it is, before they have to renegotiate with anyone, and then if they even choose to sell, if not, they can just refresh the copyright at that date and gain another 28 years.
Yeah, so the interval is actually 28 years, period.
Okay.
So it's not 7,
it's
28. It's 28.
I probably read that and thought, like, oh, it's a multiple of 7.
That's fair.
Or it's been expanded because copyright...
It was expanded.
Lifetimes have been expanded.
In 1968.
No, so it was... Okay. I probably read 28, and then it got in my head. It's a multiple of 7.
To be fair, and that's fair, because other countries it's like 6, 14. The U.S. is 28. Because our copyright laws are fucking terrible.
I mean, amazing.
No, they're terrible.
I mean, amazing.
Don't get me wrong. I like the fact that our videos, all of them except for one, are technically our copyright until all of us are dead.
Except the fact that we use other people's IPs.
With the exception of D&D, all the rest can still be ours, theoretically, because they are our original content, because it's our original story.
That's true. That's
minus
true. D&D is the fact that we're using someone else's published adventure, so
it's
their copyright.
Yes. So the rest of them are ours, which is pretty neat. So as long as all of us are one of us, as long as one of us is alive, we own the copyright for however long our life is, in addition to another 100 years. I like that. Except 100 years is kind of extreme. To be fair. So, like, our story, like, specifically, I like our Fate game story, was pretty fucking cool.
And the fact that it has to wait 100 years after any of us die is vastly increases the fact that it's gonna get forgotten.
Yeah. Pretty much.
Yeah.
I'm gonna throw this away, and then we're actually going to get back to you, and I'm gonna repeat, and then we're actually gonna go.
Oh.
At the usurpation. I think I've gotten to the point where the Dragon Blood had revolted.
Past that. And then we're talking about
the Shogunate.
The religion was.
And the Immaculate
quite
Faith.
Yeah.
Got it. Cool. For the record, that. I wanna say that the extrapolation on the Immaculate Faith is mostly just that extrapolation. Like, I don't think the developers have actually stated anything specific about how the Immaculate Faith got formed. But I'm extrapolating, and it kind of makes sense. So, headcanon!
Yes.
Also lit canon, for my players.
Sorry.
The Shogunate persists for several hundred years, during which, towards the end, some terrible things happen. I mean, like, not that people actually know that it's the end of the shogunate, because you never realize the end of an age when it's happening, but the shogunate does its best to upkeep solar philosophy and solar luxuries, amenities, that's the word I'm looking for, and solar amenities while they're happening, but it doesn't work, per se. Like, it's not exactly plausible to do, because a lot of the solar works were dependent on solar sorcery, which isn't something that anyone can replicate. An artifice that was lost in the first age. I mean, it's not... Everything that has happened to this point has been built on solar magic that is inaccessible to anyone else. And so the gens of the shogunate, gens being a house or dynastic order, do their absolute best to maintain the standard of living that they can, but their absolute best is just frankly not good enough, and things eventually deteriorate. It comes to a point where a faction of abyssals... So during this time frame, the Neverborn and the Deathlords, who are unknown to creation at this time, are doing their best to figure out what the fuck happened to the Solar Exalted, and how they... Because they understand that... The Deathlords in particular understand that the Solar Exalted were absolutely betrayed by people they trusted most. So, trying to figure out who those were and what's going on is their number one priority. And since that aligns with the goals of the Neverborn in the longer scheme, it's allowed. And so eventually they come to reason that someone captured the essences of the Exaltations and imprisoned them. And that's why the Solar Exalted are not being reborn. So the Deathlords go on an epic quest to try and figure this out. Now, at the same time, they're also trying to destroy creation at the behest of their masters. And so one of the Deathlords, who in second edition was known as... the Dowager in Unrent Veils. I think there's more to her title, but I forget what there's a middle phrase in her title, and I totally forget what that was. Wait, why was Princess Medusa punished?
No one knows.
No, they do.
It's a secret to everybody.
No.
It is.
The Dowager something something silver in Unrent Veils. Lets loose a disease, pulled from the depths of oblivion, infused with the very essence of unlife. And not unlife like, where you die and become a zombie, but unlife as an end, the antithesis of life. And lets this loose upon creation. It is the plague. It's the worst thing that could possibly happen to humanity. 99% of the population of creation is decimated. The very fabric at the edges of creation begins to unravel towards the end of the shogunate. The walls that have held back the fair folk for so long, the enemies of order and structure, begin to crumble. And expectantly, the fair folk invade. The problem with all of this is that the Dowager could not do it alone. And so... No, that's not it. No. The problem with all of this is that at the first stage, when the fair folk were pushed out of creation, they swore oaths that would bind them from entering into creation proper without invitation. Seeing the Dowager's success and being jealous of any number of things, as well as just sheer stupidity, two of the Deathlords, the Bodhisattva anointed by... No, not the Bodhisattva. The Walker in Darkness and the First and Forsaken Lion, eventually come to the terms that they must, in order to accurately end creation and bring it back into the fold of the wild, they have to invite the fair folk in order to unmake creation. And so they approach them. The First and Forsaken Lion sends his agents to approach the fair folk and invite them into creation, which allows them to bypass and circumvent their oaths. And they do. So, you know, hundreds of years after the Shogunate have taken power, after the usurpation, the contagion is killing off everyone. 1 in 100 mortals survives. At this point, it's like 10 to 100 out of every population center is just gone. Think of your 100 closest friends, and imagine that you're the only survivors from your local metropolitan area. That's it. That's all you get. And then, you're hunted by things that are completely unaffected by this plague. It's the fucking pits, to say the least. The Shogunate is on the verge of collapse. Everyone is basically effectively retreating towards the center of creation. Because that's where the elemental pole of Earth is, and that's the last place that's going to be unraveled. But I love that Nisi is, like, actually looking in my computer right now. And that's the only place that's going to be... That's the last place that's going to be unraveled by all of this. And so, you know, including a detachment of soldiers sent by one of the gens of the Shogunate, a group of 5 soldiers enter the Imperial Manse at the foot of Mount Meru, in what is at this point just a manse with its associated lands sitting in the middle of nowhere. That's not true. I mean, like, it's the last true city before you get into the slopes of Mount Meru and before you have to start actually proving that you're an exalted in order to get all the way to Meru at the top. The city of the Solar Deliberative. So it's more than just a way station in the middle of nowhere, but it's not an important city by any means. So these 5 people enter the Imperial Manse, what will become known as the Imperial Manse. One of them survives, a woman, a soldier, whose name has been lost to the sands of time. She survives. And she activates the Creation Defense Network, and she obliterates the Belorian Crusade, the Fae that have decided to invade and destroy creation and unmake it, and are actually making really good strides. She is dragon-blooded as a member of the Shogunate. And she will become known as the Scarlet Empress. No one knows the price that she paid. Under the Rose, the last supplement for second edition kind of hints that she made a deal. And that's one of several theories, is that she made a deal with the Yozi to be able to access celestial circle magic, if not beyond. Celestial circle sorceries, if not beyond. However she managed to do it, she activated the Realm Defense Grid and rods of cold iron basically fell from the skies to annihilate the Raksha that were invading through creation. Creation as it is 3/4 the size of what it originally was. Several lands that existed once upon a time are now outside the bounds of normal creation. They stand within the realms of the Raksha firmly, and they're not about to give that up. But the spread was halted. What the Death Lords come to find out is that the invasion of Raksha, the influx of wild energy, neutralized the anti-existence energy of the contagion. The contagion had every possibility of wiping out creation. But then someone fucked it up. Specifically, the First and Forsaken Lion fucked it up. So close to their ultimate goal, the Neverborn call the First and Forsaken Lion to them, and everyone hears it. So he goes because he cannot resist. And when he emerges, he is limited to one form inside of his armor. And they say that his soul has been riveted to that armor. He will never again change who he is, and he has been banished from Stygia, from the center of the underworld, to a far-off outpost nowhere near any Shadowland by which he can affect creation. That is his punishment. I don't remember what it was. That is the First and Forsaken Lion's punishment. The Walker in Darkness is punished, but no one knows exactly how or why he is punished. And a lot of people just believe that he kind of got off with a light slap on the wrist because he wasn't the instigator of the plan. The Scarlet Empress, having saved the world, effectively then uses the Imperial Lance to protect herself through all of it and declares that she is the Empress of all the known world. Challenge me, and then she drops the mic. Challenge me at your own risk is at the end of her message. Several city-states go into revolt. Several city-states are annihilated. Wiped off the map and turned into planes of glass. Proving that she's not fucking around, the Scarlet Empress calls all dragon-blooded to her as children of the same mother and founds the Empire. In the Imperial City of the Blessed Isle, she begins rebuilding civilization. To her credit, she does a lot of good. She takes a lot of stuff out of the Shogunate, and she takes a lot of stuff that didn't work, and she revises it. She is the sole monarch. And she plays her children. She creates great houses, and she plays her children against one another such that she will always retain power. You know, during this time frame, one empire stands against her. Or one region stands against her, and that is the River Provinces. Luxai, in particular, an heir to the Shogunate system, stands firmly against her with a cache of First Age technology that makes every invasion costly. Throughout its history, the Scarlet Dynasty will try three times to take Luxai and fail every time, despite superior numbers. Luxai earns its freedom. It turns one of its nearby farming regions into a plate of glass to do so that is haunted. But it earns its freedom. And several of the River Province cities take their cues from this, including Great Forks. Great Forks is a city of three gods that have banded together to support humanity. And they do so fairly well. Nearby, however, the Shadowland, and that Shadowland is inhabited by a Deathlord that will become known as Princess Magnificent with Lips of Coral. The three gods are, interestingly enough, narrative gods. One of them is the god of future victories, the other one is the god of present strife. The three gods are narratively focused. And so, when the Death Lord threatens them, the three of them come together to weave a story, backed by fate, wherein the Death Lord's secret weakness, it's never explicitly stated in the story, is discovered, and she is chased out. And by the force of their adherence to the loom of fate, and because she has afflicted the loom so much that she is now a part of it, Princess Magnificent with Lips of Coral is driven out of Three Forks. She is unable to assault them. She is effectively defeated. The Neverborn are none too thrilled by this. She has recklessly revealed herself
to not just mortals, but to gods who have proven that they can use the very fabric of creation against her. All for effectively no gain. So, the Neverborn punish her. Because she has acted against their interest, and they must punish that. By assigning Princess Magnificent with lips of coral to serve the First and Forsaken Lion for as long as they deem fit. Understandably, she is upset by this. Everyone is upset by this. Congratulations! You get to go serve the exile in his exile. You may as well be exiled, but we're too nice to say that. Bitch. So she's stuck attending him. The twist in this is that, there's this weird love story that develops between the First and Forsaken Lion and Princess Magnificent. Like, he likes that she's there with him. I'm gonna play off the fact that I'm continuously fucking up the genders by the fact that they're dead and they can actually shapeshift to be whatever the fuck they want. So, play it as you want. With the exception of the First and Forsaken Lion, who cannot shapeshift, he is inevitably bound to his armor by will of the Neverborn. That doesn't mean it's not a she bound to that armor. Great Forks rejoices because they've defeated a Death Lord, even though only the gods know what that is, and very quickly that fades out of human consciousness. Emphasis on human consciousness. So, yeah, the Scarlet Empress founds the Empire with her legions. She
Hiccups.
With her legions, she conquers a lot of the Inner Sea region and makes tributary states of a lot of creation. Like, it's not outside of the realm of realism to say that she is the Empress of the Known World. As part of that, she makes a deal with the Immaculate Faith from previously. And she declares that the Immaculate Faith is the state religion for the Empire. She gives them not only political validity, but political power as a faction to counter her children. And it works. That also means that a lot of creation subscribes to the Immaculate Faith. A lot of creation believes that the pinnacle of human achievement is dragon-blooded exaltation, and anything beyond that is anathema, which is the term by which every one of the exalted is known. Solar and lunar alike, sidereal exalted are not known by the common populace. Because, in fact, they are manipulating the Immaculate Faith to be their own fucking toy, so. I can still drink. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not spelling shit. Don't judge me!
You have been judged.
Fuck.
And been found wanting.
Oh, I'm wearing the pants with holes in the crotch, too.
Ooh! Penis?
No, it's like tiny holes.
Oh, well, maybe it's a tiny penis.
No. So.
I'm an ass!
That's really the major historical. Oh, during this time frame, by the way, during the reign of the Scarlet Empress, the solar exaltations that were not killed during calibration are still reincarnating. And so the Immaculate Faith has set up the Wild Hunt, a branch of their faith that goes out and stalks and kills solar exalted before they reach their full potential. As the Empress declares the Immaculate Faith the state religion, suddenly these people have the political backing of the largest political entity in the world. at the time. So, it continues quite effectively for several millennia. To be precise, 763 years. The Scarlet Empress, of a race that lives on average about 500 years, governs without major incident for 762 years. At this point, several people in the court and in the populace suspect that nefarious things are afoot because she has exceeded the average lifespan by 200 years.
Can't imagine why.
Can't imagine why.
No.
You're asking too much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And then in Realm Year 762, Realm Year being the reckoning by which the Empire was founded, reflecting the first date in which, or the first year in which the Empress banished the fair folk from creation, 762 years later, the Empress, who has not aged a day, disappears.